Tiny in all that air. The Philip Larkin Society podcast.
Hello and welcome to Tiny in All That Air, the Philip Larkin Society podcast. My name is Lynn Lockwood and I'm the Deputy Chair of the Philip Larkin Society. Philip Larkin never married or had children. Sometimes this is interpreted as misanthropy or the choices of a man who was completely withdrawn from the world. But I don't think that was the case. He had many long-lasting and loyal friends and admirers and lovers. Principal among these was Monica Jones, and she is the focus of today's episode. And like Larkin, also has a centenary this year, with her birthday being the 7th of May, 1922. Monica and Philip met in Leicester in 1947, where she was in post as a lecturer in English literature, and Philip was an assistant librarian. You can read some of the hundreds of letters Philip wrote to Monica and the many letters he wrote about her. However, Monica's letters to Philip have not yet been made publicly accessible. And so our understanding of her is mainly based on other people's views of her. Kingsley Amis made his dislike of her very clear, as did his son Martin. She didn't publish any academic research or any autobiographical writing. Her eccentric behaviour and dress, her heavy drinking and racist opinions present an unpleasant side to her character. But she was also a huge part of Larkin's life and his greatest love. His photography of Monica reveals his passion for her, maybe more than his letters and his actions. Before we meet our guests, we're going to hear from Monica herself. Philip and Monica often made recordings of themselves. So here is Monica, recorded by Philip in 1961, reading a poem called The Last Quadrille by Winthrop Mackworth Praed, written in 1829. And if you have never heard of Winthrop Mackworth Praed, then I don't think you'll be the only one. He is actually perhaps not a very well-known poet at all. But I found this poem moving because although it is a call for the party to never end, Praed wrote it as he was dying of tuberculosis. So there's a real sense of the shortness of life and the kind of briefness of happiness to this poem. And you can clearly see the passion that Monica has for this kind of English poetry.
The Last Quadrille. Not yet, not yet. It's hardly four. Not yet. We'll send the chair away. Mirth still has many smiles in store, and love has 50 things to say. Long leagues the weary sun must drive ere pant his hot steeds o'er the hill. The merry stars will dance till five. One more quadrille, one more quadrille. 'Tis only thus, 'tis only here that maids and minstrels may forget the myriad ills they feel or fear. Ennui, taxation, cholera, debt. With daylight, busy cares and schemes will come again to chafe or chill. This is a fairyland of dreams. One more quadrille, one more quadrille. What tricks the French in Paris play, and what the Austrians are about, and whether that tall knave Lord Grey is staying in or going out, and what the House of Lords will do at last with that eternal bill, I do not care a rush, do you? One more quadrille, one more quadrille. My book don't sell, my play don't draw, my garden gives me only weeds, and Mr. Quirk has found a flaw, deuce take him, in my title deeds. My aunt has scratched her nephew's name from that sweet corner in her will. My dog is dead, my horse is lame. One more quadrille, one more quadrille. Not yet, not yet, it is not late. Don't whisper so to Sister Jane. Your brother, I'm sure, will wait. Papa will go to cards again. Not yet, not yet. Your eyes are bright. Your step is like a wood nymph still. Oh, no, you can't be tired tonight. One more quadrille. One more quadrille.
So, in today's episode, I'm joined by Emeritus A.C. Bradley Professor of Modern Literature at Liverpool University, Kelvin Everest, whose book Keats and Shelley, Winds of Light, has just been published by Oxford University Press. Kelvin took up a lectureship in English literature in 1979 at Leicester University and worked alongside Monica until she retired in 1981. I'm also joined by Dr. Jane Bluett, who is a long-standing teacher of A-level English literature and English language. She is a published poet, reviewer of poetry, and a researcher into the practice of poetry. She is currently poetry editor of English in Education. She enjoys literature of all kinds, but poetry is her first love. She's always been on the fence about Philip Larkin the man, but in the field about Philip Larkin the poet. We start by discussing John Sutherland's recent book, Monica Jones, Philip Larkin and Me, Her Life and Long Loves, published by Weidenfeld in 2021. What did you think of John Sutherland's book?
I liked it. I found it very, very interesting because it overlapped with my own life so much. He was way earlier than I was, and I wasn't a student. I was a lecturer, and he'd been gone a long time, a very long time by the time I got there. But the pubs that he used to drink in, particularly the Clarendon, was the same pub. I lived in the same part of Leicester. And that's where Monica lived too. I can't remember exactly the address, but it was just by the park. What was that park called? Clarendon Park.
Yeah.
And I thought that the book was a good account of Monica, except that it was a little bit sadder about her than she actually seemed to me, you know? To me, she wasn't a tragic figure at all, but I hadn't seen her journey to that point, and I didn't know the all that had gone on between her and Larkin by that time. This was 1979. Mm. She did bring Larkin to events at Leicester, one in particular, which I'd be happy to tell you the story of, and I met him through her. I found her just a bit more fun and vibrant than the book led her to seem. But that may be a limitation in the book from my point of view, that is just owing to the fact that he didn't get around to talking to me, because he didn't have any proper sources for that period, as far as I could see, except for my friend Martin Stannard, who was appointed at the same time as I was, and who knew Monica less well, or not really very well at all, mainly through me, actually. But I think because Martin had published something about Monica, or something in which he mentions Monica, John Sutherland went to him, and then that was it. So, but I mean, compared to, say, Martin Amis's account of Monica, which I think is absolutely horrible, I think it was an affectionate, serious attempt to see, to try to do justice to the stature of her and her importance in Larkin's life and in his career.
Mm-hmm. So what was your first impression of her? Can you remember, like, when you first met her?
I can absolutely remember, because I was interviewed for a job at Leicester when would that have been? About June, probably, to the end of the academic year 78-9. I had a lectureship in the University of Wales at a place called Lampeter, St David's University College, Lampeter. That was my first job, which I got when I was very young, actually. So I was still only 28 when I went to Leicester. And while they kept Monica a long way away from the interview process, they couldn't keep her away from a kind of reception thing where all the candidates met loads of the department, department, in fact, you know, the kind of thing. So there's people milling about. And Monica was extremely noticeable. She wore very brightly coloured hooped tights, if that's the word, you know, sort of...
Yeah, the sort of stripy tights, yeah.
Stripy tights, but going round, you know, not up and down.
Yeah.
And which were, you know, clearly defiant, kind of defiant outfit. And she had a very distinctive voice, of course, with a rather kind of whooping, seizing on something daft or funny that someone might have said. She was terribly funny at that time, you know. But she was drunk, of course. But she wasn't a drunk, I wouldn't say, at all. She just got drunk.
Mm.
You know what I mean? You know, God knows, I know enough people like that, especially in academia. you know, myself included, really.
Yeah, and those sort of events, they're not really bearable unless you are drunk, really, on the whole.
Or unless you're trying to get a job, yeah. there were three posts being advertised at that time together, which was quite a big thing for the department, a bit of a turnover there, because it wasn't that big. I guess the probably less than 20 staff.
Right.
But I mean, that's off the top of my head. But in fact, Martin wasn't there on that day because something came up or something. He was at head of fellowship at Edinburgh at the time. But do I remember introducing myself to Monica, and she didn't, you know, she just stared at me and listened politely or not very politely to my attempt to make conversation. So I clearly can see her now in that leaning against the wall at that do, whatever, wherever that was. But then she got very much more well disposed towards me, because at that time I used an MCC diary.
Cricket, exactly.
And I used this diary. This was obviously long before anything other than proper diaries, you know, which you actually write things in the diary. Mm. I used it in my first departmental meeting I went to, and Monica picked up on it straight away, and sort of said, "Oh, really, you like cricket? I go to cricket a lot." And I did go to cricket a lot, as I still do to this day. I go to Lord's a lot. I have a close friend who's a member. I'm not a member myself, unfortunately. And so we sort of really rather bonded over that.
Mm.
And so she was always ready with a kind of to have a whispered gag with me, you know, when there was a discussions going on and things like that. And I really liked her. I mean, she was a bit wild, you know, and she was... I remember one particularly funny performance she put on, must have been the summer of 1980, because I don't know if you two are academics or not, but when you set finals questions, or in those days when you did, you had the responsibility to set, either alone or with another, the questions for a paper with which you were closely associated the teaching of. And then you had a big meeting in which everybody commented on everybody's questions. And this meeting was on a Saturday morning. And Monica was hilarious in it, picking up on sort of inelegancies and infelicities or stupidities or, you know, possible scope for ambiguity created by people's questions that they'd ask. And she wasn't doing it really in a constructive spirit, but in a kind of as an expression of her sense of the absurd side of teaching literature.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know, the kind of assessment tools and...
Yeah. Mm, yes. Yeah. me and Jane are very familiar, because we've got a shared past in doing exactly that.
So she was poking fun at it and at us and at the whole business of it, which wasn't to be confused with poking fun at English literature or needing to make sure that people knew about it, but which she was extremely serious and passionate, you know, advocate of old, what you might call old style canonical literature, understood as a very deep thing, a broad knowledge of which she felt was an essential thing to instill in a student. And she had a tremendous range of reading, obviously. So those are particular early memories.
Yeah, I was going to just ask about how is she seen in the department, you know, in terms of, you know, we know she famously didn't publish and kind of rallied against that whole kind of the idea of the career academic. So how was she, tolerated or celebrated or?
Well, I was a junior person, you know, and it was, we only overlapped within the department for a couple of years.
Mm.
And so I wasn't really in a position to know how the powers that be, as it were, thought of her.
Mm.
I mean, she was obviously from an earlier era and hadn't had and wasn't having the kind of career that was beginning to be the normal thing.
Mm.
I'd only got the job because I'd published my first book. So that kind of business had started then, you know, you could really get a full-time permanent lectureship unless you had published something reasonably substantial, at least, and together with plans, you know, and so on. And, you know, where do you hope to be in the next 5 years? Those kind of questions were already being asked in interviews and so on.
Mm-hmm.
So she wasn't out of that bag at all. And I don't know, she was part of the department and part of the array of rather old school characters of various sorts. So Philip Collins, the Dickensian scholar, who was quite interesting, you know, man himself with his eccentricities and so on. And there was Arthur Humphreys, who was the head of, the ex head of department, but and retired in fact by then. Come to think of it, but still around, and his wife was still. So, and you get a sense of the flavour of Arthur Humphrey's reign, which must have been a lot of about Monica's career, actually, in that I know that it's a fact that a male and female undergraduate who got engaged while they were at Leicester doing English asked his permission if they could get engaged.
Really? Wow.
So it was a very paternalistic thing and must have been a source of great amusement as well as frustration to someone like Monica, you know, in lots of different ways. I know she'd very much retained a loyalty to a much earlier head of department, you know, from way back before anyone by then could remember, really. You know, sort of that must have been 25 years in the past at that time. But she didn't give me the impression that she was being hooted from the stage or anything. You know, she was, it was quite common for people to be drunk quite a lot of the time then. It seems to have stopped now, but it was very, very straightforwardly the case that most English Brahmins would have some heavy drinkers.
Yeah.
Yes, we know.
Yeah, I can remember when I was at university and you. But I think also the big characters, the larger than life characters, are what make a department. Mm. You know, especially at an English department, they're inevitable. Yeah. I think they're important. Mm.
Was there still much discussion of which university you'd originally attended?
Well, I mean, you mean an Oxbridge?
Mm-hmm.
Do you know that still goes on?
Oh, I know.
You know, there is definitely a sense of special category and some kind of vague entitlement for people who've been to Oxford or Cambridge. I don't remember getting any of that from Monica or you know, that doesn't feature in my recollection as well. This was a long time ago now, 40 years or whatever it was. Was it 40 years? I don't know. Yes.
It's something that John Sutherland makes quite a lot of in his book, isn't it?
As I said before, he was much earlier than I was, and he was as well. I mean, Leicester department was full of people that didn't have Oxford degrees as well as some that did. Where did you do your degree?
UCL.
Uh-huh. Well, that's not that modern these days either.
It never was.
No, it certainly wasn't. Yeah, how about you, Lynn? Where?
Sheffield.
Did you do English?
Yeah, I did English literature, yeah. So that was 89 to 92.
So well after Empson then?
Yes, yeah. Although my English teacher bought me Seven Types of Ambiguity when I finished school.
Yeah.
And I was a bit like, that's a bit difficult. Fun reading.
Well, I'm looking forward to this. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. John Huffenden was there. Mick Hathaway was my tutor, yeah. Yeah, he was great. So there were some fantastic teachers there.
But yeah, yes, in the old red bricks. Well, and still in the red bricks, you get good English departments with a range of interesting people, certainly. And yeah, there are a few characters about, but they tend to need to be able to publish as well now.
Yeah.
I always found at UCL it was certainly there weren't many of them that dedicated to teaching as such.
Yeah.
But those that did were certainly the ones that stood out.
The teachers make a difference. Has changed in the last 20 years, actually. There's much more emphasis on the student experience, as it's called. And but still, yeah.
Yeah. So, Monica met Philip Larkin in 1947 when he came to work at the library there. But at that point, he was, well, as always, involved with somebody else, as was the story throughout their lives, really. Obviously, they seemed to have a very strong attachment, I think, quite quickly. You know, they became friends. Quite firm friends, and before they became a kind of more serious relationship. So when was it that you met Philip Larkin then?
Well, the main time I remember was when we did a production in the university of The Winter's Tale. This was the University Drama Society, not the English department. And I was Autolycus. I had done a lot of acting, actually, but earlier on in my career and in my teenage years. So I was quite an experienced actor. And I knew that it was known that Monica was going to bring Larkin to see this production. I guess it must have been probably the autumn of 1980 or possibly the spring of 81, around there. She did bring him. He sat in the front row. and he looked exactly like Philip Larkin, if you know. You know, there was no mistaking him. It was in the very front row, and we went through the show, and then there was a party afterwards. Mm. Must have been the last night, I suppose. We did it for about four nights, as I remember, and Monica introduced me to Larkin. So I said, "How did you enjoy the play?" And he said, I'm totally deaf. I couldn't hear a thing." And that's presumably why he was in the front row.
Why he was in the front row.
in context, it really was quite a funny thing, the way he said it. You know, sort of, you know, you must be wondering why then did I come? And so, but he was dryly sort of urbanely kind of not patronizing, but not in any way warm or, you know. Mm. But then later on, he got pretty drunk as well, as did we all. And so then we talked a bit more. And then out of the blue, I mean, with no preparatory context, he said to me, "FSSU doth rule my life." So glancing allusion to Malvolio in Twelfth Night, but substituting MOAI with FSSU, the initials of the University Superannuation Scheme.
Oh, that's brilliant.
That's really quite funny. Yeah. So that was my most close up experience of Larkin. She used to talk quite a bit about him because my wife Faith and I we were already married by then. She'd come with me from Wales, and she, you know, we're still married, and she too remembers these evenings. Monica was very kind of hospitable to us, and would ask us round to her flat, which I think was in Stonygate. It was I can see the street now. It was close to Clarendon Park. It was a short walk to it from where we lived. and it was went up some stairs into her flat. And she would have cooked, and you know, there'd be plenty of nice stuff to drink, and we just chat about this and that. Must have done that a few times. And as I mentioned in my message to you, Lynn, about this, she was funny, and she's very clever and funny and vibrant, really, although also battered and, to me, old. I mean, she was a lot younger then than I am now, but there you are. That's how you get, see these things. And she was, we enjoyed those evenings. And that was the thing about the John Sutherland book that I felt was a missing fit bit of the picture, you know, that she hadn't at, by that stage sunk into a completely kind of miserable, marginalized, hopeless blankness.
No.
Which is kind of what you assume from that book. And from other books, but other, you know, is it Andrew Motion that's written a biography of Larkin?
Yes, it is.
Yeah, I've read that. Yes. That too didn't get her at all, I didn't think. Late Monica. There was the cricket that went on being a big thing between us. And one particular episode that I've always remembered is that our phone rang in the days when you had landlines, you know, and they had a proper ring. Then a phone ringing at 3 a.m. was a really worrying thing. So I went belting downstairs and picked the phone up, and it was Monica. And she said, "He's out. He's out. He's been caught blind for 32. She's listening to the cricket in Australia on the radio.
Oh, fabulous.
She has assumed in her inebriated state that I would be too. But she's found up, you know, in the very middle of the night.
Wow.
But, you know, no matter.
Because that was something she kind of did in her later days, wasn't it, actually, that she would phone people up at all hours.
Yes, in fact, you know, I did a bit of poking around, and when England played series in Australia, and I think that phone call must have been after she retired. I think she might, I've forgotten this, but I think she must have gone on phoning us up. That's ringing a vague bell now, in fact. I think she did go on phoning us up erratically. But that some of the things I'm remembering may have been after she'd retired. You know, if there was a period when she went on living in that flat in Leicester but had retired from the university, then there might have been, that might have explained why she was kept inviting us round. I mean, just to see somebody, maybe.
I just
can't remember now.
When I was preparing for this, I thought I'd try and look into a bit to some of the writers that Monica championed. I said to Jane, "Oh, let's read some George Crabbe." And then I've never studied Crabbe. Crabbe wasn't on any of my syllabuses. I've never taught Crabbe. And I didn't really read a lot, to be honest, but very, very traditional kind of the stuff that's completely fallen out of fashion. And I was wondering if it was kind of a bit out of fashion even when Monica was teaching it.
What you need to realise is that by 1979, when I went there, the whole theory thing had completely exploded.
So
Monica was utterly, utterly out of that. You know, it was getting to the point where the first year introductory course was one third theory, feminism, Marxism, structuralism. I lectured on structuralism when I first went to Leicester, and you certainly couldn't really even, well, you would have found it quite difficult to get a job unless you're a medievalist or something, but even then. So in terms of what was fashionable, blimey, never mind George Crabbe. I mean, George Pratt's never been fashionable. I mean, he's, funny enough, the Benjamin Britten's opera, Peter Grimes, just a couple of weeks ago. So, but it is really quite dour, as well as being, you know, kind of these days a bit obscure. Mm. It's what's it called? The Borough. It's not short, and it's not funny.
Is that where the story of Peter Grimes comes from, isn't it? One of the sections from that. Yeah. And that's an amazing story.
It is weird. Yeah. Very weird. Yeah. But lots of other weirdness. So yes, being a devotee of Crab wouldn't put you in the vanguard in 1979. Mm. I'm sure Crab wouldn't have been taught then. I mean, I am a romanticist, so strictly speaking, it's kind of my period that. And I have read Crab, but I've never taught Crab or been taught Crab. I can't remember anything about what Monica was actually teaching at that time.
Jane, I get the impression from you, you're not 100% in the Larkin camp. So well, what is it that interests you about Monica and Larkin?
You're absolutely right. And I didn't come to Philip Larkin until quite late, until I had to teach it. And the poetry is fabulous. You can't, not enjoy the poetry. Some of the attitudes, possibly. And Monica, I'd always just been aware of as this person who stood behind him, another one of the women like Emma Hardy, who, no acknowledgement at all and is being rescued now. And reading John Sutherland's book, I really started to think, well, got a lot in common. I mean, anybody over a certain age being at certain types of university knows what it's like to be a girl in that environment, in heavily male-dominated environments where three people I was at university with are now professors. It's always been of interest to me how that sort of situation works. So there were very few women around when I was at university in terms of lecturing. And to see somebody that actually took the teaching so seriously and obviously had a passion for English literature, as you said before, I think it's quite inspiring, and that she stuck it out for so long in one department, obviously believing in what she did. Presumably she wasn't completely stuck there, even though that's where Larkin put her in a box, as they say. But I've really enjoyed finding out more about her. She's quite compelling.
It is really interesting because I think, that Monica's life, I mean, I put a tweet about this on our Twitter account just last week. It's a life that's really told for a lot of male voices. And she seemed to, enjoy the company of men. She seemed to have, I don't really know of any close women friends that come through very strongly in anything about her. When I first got interested in Philip Larkin and joined the society and started learning more about him beyond his poetry, I was very struck by Monica, just the style of how she looks. I think she's very iconic. And, Philip, it brought out Philip Larkin's photographic skill, because he was able to photograph Monica in such an amazing way. And it's quite nice to remember him as a photographer, as a very accomplished photographer. And there's a picture of her where she's wearing kind of aviator glasses and a headscarf, and she looks incredibly dramatic. And I love the picture on the front of, I presume the picture on the front of John Sutherland is a self-portrait, a selfie that Philip Larkin took, where they're on the beach. And that is an amazing picture as well. And Monica's got that beautiful kind of mini beehive hairstyle, and You know, it's incredibly romantic. So he was able to capture a lot of sides to Monica, the glamorous side, a playful side, a thoughtful side, a really kind of fashionable, you know, somebody that loved dressing up. And even in her older years, I really liked the kind of trouser suits and very bold, you know, and bold kind of floral prints and things like that.
But she must have been in her late 50s, mustn't she, when I met her?
Yeah.
I was only 28. So she just seemed like a different generation altogether, you know.
But she wasn't kind of being held back by the kind of conventions of how an academic woman should dress. I think she was very expressive in how she dressed.
You're right about her relating to men. I mean, she definitely, even with me and my wife and I, it was kind of me she was relating to.
Mm. Do you think she was one of the boys in that sort of sense?
Well, that's not
how she saw herself.
Yeah, I mean, I can imagine that she earlier.
Yeah.
It would have been much more obviously the case. But as I keep repeating, by this time, there were no boys for her to be one of around her. And I don't recall that anyone else was ever invited to dinner along with us. So I think it was partly just someone that she could relate to, because she could also talk to and be friendly with, you know. But the Sutherland thing talks a lot about boozing in the Clarendon pub, which was still there and still where you went boozing if you lived in Clarendon Park, as everybody did.
Mm.
And it sounded you know, identical, really. It just seemed the same pub. And I can easily imagine Monica in there.
Yeah.
But I never did see her in there.
Okay. She did have an influence on Philip Larkin's writing, though, didn't she? And she was one of the few people that he would run drafts of poetry by and talk to about his writing. And he seemed to really respect her opinion on the whole.
You know that story about him not being able to finish Arundel Tomb?
Yes.
The stone fidelity they hardly meant has come to be their final, I need something heraldic, two syllables, and
Monica it
plays on. Yeah, and I can hear her saying it now, really.
He shouts out, doesn't he? I need a word. Just like blazing.
That's a good example of her quickness and sort of sharp intellect she had, even at that time with the booze having taken a bit of a toll and physically looking a bit battered.
Yeah.
She did look a bit battered. The outfit I described to you with the hoops, hoop tights, I mean, one of the things you'd think is that's not really quite doing her the best justice, you know. It looked like kind of slightly crazy choice of clothes for a woman of that age and appearance. I'm sure on purpose and defiantly, but also just on the edge of being a bit weird as well.
Yeah.
Eccentric, shall we say. In a not necessarily, you know, sort of that hinterland people can get into where eccentricity could be construed as a slightly kind of more weird thing. you know, like they might be slightly losing it somehow.
Yeah, there was some descriptions of Monica in this the little book, Haydon Bridge Love Story. It's a kind of a by the people that lived in Haydon Bridge. There are some really interesting first-hand accounts of Monica and, you know, what she looked like. There's one, I'll see if I can find, it's a really good story about she walks past a child. Sometimes she just wore, like, head to toe the same colour, like all white, for example, or black. So Monica is still... This is about Monica dressing in all black. And Dennis Telford, who wrote the book, he says, I'm reminded of a story June Willis told me. As a young boy, her son Tony turned the post office corner with his scooter just as Miss Jones came hurrying in the opposite direction along Church Street from the railway station. And everyone in Haydon Bridge called her Miss Jones. That's what she was known as. Black hat, black dress, black framed glasses, and a black cape billowing out behind as the west wind funneling down Ratcliffe Road caught underneath it. Tony's response to his mother was immediate. Bloody hell, I've just seen Batman.
That's brilliant.
Yeah. We had thought we might talk about one or two of the poems, maybe. Obviously, we've talked about her influence on Arundel Toon. There's, I think Talking in Bed is, is a poem that he wrote about Monica, which is, he didn't write many poems that were directly about Monica or influenced by Monica. And I suppose the two most obvious ones are Talking in Bed and Show Saturday. We talked about Show Saturday in the podcast in December, and we actually read the whole poem and talked about the whole poem. And the idea that that was perhaps the closest he got to a love poem to Monica, really.
Really?
Yeah, because he loved going to the shows with her, and he loved that kind of time spent. I think he didn't want her to buy Hayden Bridge originally. I think he was a bit unsure about it. Why buy somewhere that's 150 miles away from Hull and in the middle of nowhere and you can't drive? Because the train journey was quite difficult for her to get to Hayden Bridge, especially when Beeching closed a couple of branch lines. She had a really torturous route to get up there.
Still is.
Yeah. But I think once he actually got there and he stood in the back garden and he saw the river coming past, it is amazing. I don't know if either of you have been there and seen the cottage, but it's right on the riverbank, and it's beautiful to see. And I think then Larkin was quite sort of enchanted by it, and they started to see the cottage as a kind of, well, I think it was for them an escape. It was an escape for Larkin because he wasn't accosted by anybody as he was walking down the road. Mm. He didn't like public appearances very much, and he would grumble in his letters about people wanting to talk to him about poetry and things like that. I think he just quite liked to be able to walk down the road and go to the pub and go to the shop and just have a kind of quiet life. So I think Show Saturday sort of celebrates that.
I wouldn't call Talking in Bed a love poem, though. I mean, it's a sort of not love poem. It's about wishing, how hard it would be to be seriously honest about what you really do feel about someone you've nevertheless spent almost your entire life with, as it were.
Mm, yeah.
I once heard Seamus Heaney read it, and in introducing it, he said it was one of his favourite poems by Larkin, but he read it as a very kind of chastening, rather bleak poem, really.
It is, and the image of the sort of dark towns and the clouds, it's like in Dockery in somewhere, you've got the image of the sandstorm coming up, and an image of dread, really.
Mm. I think that's always the case with Larkin, is you find a poem, you think, well, maybe this could be the love poem, this could be a poem, and there's always ambiguity and undercutting. Even Arundel Tomb, it's the not quite.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Our instinct almost true is like not untrue and not unkind, not untrue. Mm.
Jane, do you want to read Talking in Bed? We've not featured that one on the podcast before, so it'd be nice to actually hear it.
Yeah, okay. Just find it. Talking in Bed. Talking in Bed ought to be easiest. Lying together, there goes back so far, an emblem of two people being honest. Yet more and more time passes silently. Outside, the wind's incomplete unrest builds and disperses clouds about the sky. And dark towns heap up on the horizon. None of this cares for us. Nothing shows why, at this unique distance from isolation, it becomes still more difficult to find words at once true and kind, or not untrue and not unkind. Ooh, I can imagine Seamus Heaney doing it.
Yeah, definitely.
Justice to that.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Very nice.
Yeah, thank you, Jane. That's lovely. But yeah, that it's got so many kind of very typical Larkin features, hasn't it? You know, like the winds, incomplete unrest, and those, you know, and like you say, not untrue and not unkind.
Also formally so tight though, and rhymes so snappy. That it's a brilliant little poem, really, isn't it?
And you've got the emblem of two peoples, Arundel Tomb again, isn't it?
Yeah. Like you say, like the Arundel Tomb, what it represents on the surface isn't what's actually happening. And so much of Monica's life was just directed by Larkin's other relationships with other women. And he was so, his letters take my breath away sometimes, where he's so sort of open about what's happening sometimes and expects Monica to kind of just deal with it. And then other times quite cagey and doesn't tell her things. And it's as if she doesn't really have a chance to know what's going on a lot of the time. And I think that's where, you know, the headlines that you often get about her being this kind of, you know, this victim of Larkin, you know, me and Jane have talked about this before, that makes me feel a bit uncomfortable, really, seeing her as a kind of victimized woman. Because everything that you say, for example, Kelvin, actually shows her strength and her kind of passion for life.
Yes, it was a strange relationship. Hard to put yourself in the place of Larkin, really.
Yeah.
Why he couldn't just have been more honest, but he was quite a hung-up sort of a character. Sexual intercourse began in 1963 between Lady Chatterley Band and the Beatles. And he was before like that, wasn't he? He was kind of shaped by a different England.
Yeah.
And he never even tried to move on from it, really, did he?
No. And their devotion for each other was just, you know, it didn't waver despite everything, despite, Larkin's frailties or unpleasantness or whatever, however you want to describe them. When I was rereading the Andrew Motion biography, just kind of keeping an eye on Monica in the story, as it were, and I'd completely forgotten, because it's not till you get right to the end, that the title of the book, A Writer's Life, is, you know, is what Monica said. And I know I've sort of said, oh, I feel like sometimes she's a woman whose story is told by men and perhaps not always very fairly, but actually the fact that Motion chose to use Monica's words to sum up Larkin, I found very moving. And, you know, that it was her choice to put writer on Larkin's gravestone. And, you know, that she was there championing him as a writer all the way, you know, through their lives together.
Why do you think Martin Amis is so horribly vitriolic about in his account of her? She was such a clash with his world, I suppose.
I think, yeah, there's definitely that. And I think there's a sense that Kingsley Amis was quite threatened by Monica and didn't like the attention that Larkin gave her over him.
I get that impression as well.
Do you think so? Yeah.
I mean, you've got the big bromance and then poor Monica trying to get in the middle.
But Larkin spent much more time with Monica ultimately, and you know, his visits to see Kingsley were kind of quite sporadic, really. I mean, Kingsley never came to Hull, never visited Hull. My reading of Kingsley is that he kind of hero worshipped Larkin, really, and couldn't get past Monica, couldn't get the attention away. Martin Amis was kind of defending his father, really, and just taking it to that further degree, really. It is vitriolic, though, isn't it? Considering did he meet her once in person? He had no real relationship with her.
It's gleefully cruel, really.
I get the impression she would never make friends with women.
She liked the boys, didn't she? Yeah. She liked the boys. And I think that comes across so strongly in the John Sutherland book.
Yeah.
You know, they were important to her and they made her feel accepted and attractive and also in control because she was older and more sophisticated and whatever.
And it's clever. I think you can't underestimate that.
Mm.
You know, somebody who's as academically able as she was and the sort of treatment that she was being meted out to her, I think was shocking, really.
It's interesting when you go up to the cemetery at Cottingham and you've got Larkin's gravestone that Monica, you know, chose and put up. And then when she died, her stone looks very similar to his and he's in the cemetery. And then Maeves is in there as well. Oh, and it's like, he couldn't get away from them.
Oh, no.
He's kind of in between both of them. Jane and I met a good 10 years or so ago and have worked together in the A-level examination system as well as in a range of creative writing settings. So we thought we'd put our poetry hats on and share a little of our own work inspired by Philip Larkin. So in 2015, I went on holiday to Croatia. Was it 2014? Might have been 2014, I went on holiday to Croatia. And I took a ton of books out there because obviously you're in Dubrovnik. Why wouldn't you want to read a ton of books about Philip Larkin and stuff like that instead of just sitting on the beach? But I did manage to go and get in the sea. So I kind of had a bit of a head full of Larkin. But at the same time, near the hotel, just sort of the sea, there's like a kind of bay in Dubrovnik. It's one of my favourite places in the world. And it's kind of an inlet that's about 3 foot deep. So you can stand in it. And it's like being in the shallow end of the swimming pool. But it's warm and there's fish swimming around. And there's little old kind of Croatian old fishermen. You know, and it's just beautiful. And I think it must be quite salty or something because you can float really easily in it.
Mm.
I suppose because it is a sea, you know, it's seawater and it's a sort of inlet. So you just float so easily in it. And I just absolutely, just one of my favourite places in the world. So, this is kind of where I wrote this poem in my head. So it's called Larkin in Croatia. He is 1,605 miles and 68 years from me. He is Oxford quadrangles, Lamprey School, lousy modern daubs, an undersized boy, soft as a seed in thistle, an air of beauty, cheap overcoats, packing crates and shaving lotion, deference, etchings, dons and fresh cigarettes, scouts more or less imaginary in his unambitious short story. I float on the Adriatic waters, bougainvillea balconies reflected on my glittering skin and the water's surface. Black fish worry around me and seaweeds fronds run gentle fingertips along my thighs. Salt trickles into my mouth as my nodding husband lights another cigarette over espresso and Miles Davis biography in the shady bar. He does not know my unfaithfulness with salt and sea, with a lover who casts his spell over me through words and distance. I travelled to Hull and drank gin and champagne in the station hotel, ran my hands along the cool, smooth concrete of the Humber Bridge, mouthed yes outside the entrance to Pearson Park, the black boy, the white heart. At King's Cross, I drank black midnight coffee beneath his plaque and cried, obscured by hectic travellers and patient queues for cash machines, hoping for transformation, hoping to be made magnificent, read about by generations to come, my mundanity rewritten in lyric and meter.
Lovely.
Thank you.
Wow.
I'm sure it's the only poem that links Croatia and
Larkin.
Larkin.
Unique. It's unique.
Yeah, that's what poetry does, isn't it?
Absolutely.
Quite a few of those lines are nicked from Larkin anyway. So
of course.
I can't remember where I got it from. I know soft as a seeding thistle.
You've got your overwhelming yes in there.
Of course, yeah, the yes, yeah. I haven't written any other poetry about Larkin since then. So
I like the infidelity. That's brilliant. I mean, that's, yeah. You've got him, haven't you?
Oh, thank you. So, your poem, very different from my poem.
Yep.
Not quite as sexy as my poem.
It's because it's not remotely personal, that's Okay, this is a poem I wrote when I was first teaching Wits and Weddings, as it's a good way to engage with poetry is to write your own response to it, particularly when I've always had an on-off relationship with Larkin and never been too sure I should like him or not. But I do like some of it.
Yeah.
Okay, so you'll recognise this. It's a response to Wild Oats and other bits and bobs. Dear Mr. Larkin, I think I met you at a station. I remember your inch-thick specs, your large hands ungloved, the receding hairline. You talked to my friend. They all did in the end, as I waltzed off in nylons and shoes à la mode. I never read books, but loved the jazz, the dudes, their smiles, their talk, up close and personal. They loved the fur, the bosomy sacks, the dark, grunting silence. Had I met you twice, I might have smiled. I'm not someone to talk to. With your inch-thick specs, you might have thought me beautiful.
It is a bit sexy, your face. It's hard to write about Larkin with being sexy, I think.
Yeah.
He just kind of has that air about him.
Not sexy at all.
I don't know what it is about him.
So big.
Can you
imagine being behind him if he was sitting in the front row?
Oh, that'd be a nightmare.
Help him with me.
I mean, I can't sit behind anybody because I'm only, you know, 2'7". So Larkin would have definitely dwarfed. Monica would have probably dwarfed me. Thank you so much to Jane and Kelvin for joining us today and giving us so much insight into Monica Jones. Thank you also to Philip Pullen, good friend of the podcast and the chair of Larkin 100, for kindly lending us the recordings of Monica. This podcast is one of the many centenary events that are taking place to celebrate 100 years since Larkin's birth. So please head over to our website to find out what's happening. There will be events taking place in Hull, Coventry, Leicester, Wellington and Oxford, to name a few. A hello to some of our new Twitter followers, Slightly Foxed Magazine, the magazine and podcast for book lovers, Claire, who calls herself Pimsian Boiled Egg on Toast, Carla Sarrett, Unremarkable Narrator, and my friends at George Street Community Bookshop in Glossop. I'll leave you with the second reading from Monica Jones. This time, it is Thomas Hardy's poem, The End of the Episode.
Indulge no more, may we, in this sweet, bitter pastime. The love light shines the last time between you, dear, and me. There shall remain no trace of what so closely tied us, and blank as ere love eyed us will be our meeting place. The flowers and thymy air, will they now miss our coming? The dumbbells thin their humming, to find we haunt not there? Though fervent was our vow, though ruddily ran our pleasure, bliss has fulfilled its measure, and sees its sentence now. Ache deep, but make no moans, smile out, but stilly suffer. The paths of love are rougher than thoroughfares of stones.